Hey, everybody. I'm just dusting off this little owl. This little owl is something that belongs to my wife. She's had it for maybe, I don't know, 40 years at least. It was a gift from somebody that she knew. Long ago. There's an inscription on the bottom of it. It has the person's name. It also says France, 1975. So I'm not sure what it's made out of. Don't know if it's quartz. Maybe it's quartz. It has that look about it. As you can see, his little ears. Or her little ears, I'm not sure, male or female, but the little ears are chipped. That's a shame. I'm not sure why, but I kind of like this little owl. We'll just set him. We'll set the little owl right there. Now, some of you remember what kind of pen this is. That's a vintage Parker 51. Here's another one. Vintage. And these pens are from the 1940s and 50s. Another one. This one is I don't know if you can see it because of the shadows. Let me put this notebook in front. Let me see, this one's longer. So the shorter model is referred to as a demi. It's just a shorter version of the Parker 51. Now, the 51, as I've spoke about in previous videos, is it's a world-renowned fountain pen. Other companies have tried to copy it. Even Parker recently released their own remake of it, a more modern version. Parker 51 reissue. And I do have a video or two that features this pen. Jinhao, a Chinese pen maker, tried to copy the reissue. They did a reasonable job. And I have a video that features this pen. I also have the brand is Hero, H-E-R-O. Hero. This is a Hero 100. One of my early ASMR videos featured this pen. So if you go back in my archives many years, you can find a video. I believe I unboxed this pen. I probably inked it in that video. But it's a reasonable copy. A little bit longer. If you try to buy one of these vintage 51s, you're going to pay, I don't know, probably around $100 to $150, maybe. This reissue that just came out, what, last year? I've already forgotten. I think you're going to pay about $150 to $250. For this pen, depending on which version you get. I think this is the deluxe version. It's got a gold filled cap and a gold nib. But there's other, you know, there's other avenues that you can take if you want a pen that looks very similar to a Parker 51. Now, in a previous video, I know I did a little bit of a teaser where I kind of showed you this and told you that we would unpackage these in a future video, and that's what we're about to do. These copies of the Parker 51 are designated as a 51A. It's made by Jinhao. 51A. It also says, looks like, I'm not sure, it looks like it, the word on the left says Zoo Hot. Is that what that says? Zoo Hot, 2 pieces. Okay, so they come in this little felt. Feels like some kind of felt case. Now, to be quite honest with you, when I purchased these, they're pretty pens, but actually I don't remember what color they are. Let's take a look. Well, I think there's a pen in there somewhere. Yeah. Let's put the cap back on. Wow. Would you look at that? Would you look at that? Is that something or what? Well, that's gorgeous. That thing is beautiful. Let's take a look at the other one. I hope it's as pretty as that first one. Matches the owl. Boy, what a good looking pen. So, next to a vintage Parker 51. You can see the Jinhao is much longer. Here's the Hero 100. It looks like it's just a tad longer than the Hero. So yeah, this is a pretty lengthy pin has some length to it. Ounces. .7. How does that compare to the vintage? The vintage Parker is just a little bit lighter. It's 0.6 ounces. The Parker 51 reissue. It's 0.8. The Jinhao copy of the reissue. 0.9. And the Hero 100. 0.7. Size-wise, .442 of an inch, right there, close to the cap. And the Parker is the same, 444 thousandths of an inch. Or very close to it. The largest part of the cap is about 470 thousandths of an inch. The Jinhao 51A is 491 thousandths. You know, the style dial caliper makes a very pleasing sound. It's not supposed to make that sound. If I press the dial downward a little bit, I can make the sound go away. But I kind of like the sound. Speaking of sound, I'm still experimenting with microphones and microphone equipment. I have an audio processor now, and I've been playing with the settings, trying to figure out, you know, the best way to use it. It has a lot of features on it, like a de-esser, a noise gate to kind of block out background noise. It seems pretty neat if I can figure out, you know, exactly how to use it. What do you say we ink this pen up? Now, for this pen, I think we're going to use, let's see, what do we have? We're going to use this Levenger Cobalt Blue. Over to the side. I wasn't sure what color the pens were, so I wasn't sure what color ink I wanted. And I chose Cardinal Red and Cobalt Blue. Both of these are made by Levenger. And I had them sitting off to the side. But now that I see the colors of the pen, we can still use the Cobalt Blue in this pen. But in this other pen, we're going to use Diamine Ancient Copper. I'm going to make a reach for it. It may make some noise, but let's see if I can reach. Yeah, I got it. Diamine Ancient Copper. I think that'll be a good fit. Here's a little piece of cat. My cat. My wife's cat. Was walking around up here on the desk recently. So let's ink up this nice, pretty, green and blue one. I really like that green. Some of you know by now that green is my favorite color. I'm going to zoom in a little bit. I don't use autofocus. I usually hold up a little piece of paper like this, and I touch my screen. And it sets the focus. I don't use autofocus because the microphones are so sensitive that they pick up the internal sounds of the camera's focusing system. It's crazy, I know. I'm kind of out of sorts in this video. It's maybe because I'm really exhausted, but yeah, that is beautiful. Okay, so this pen comes with an ink converter. As a lot of you know, an ink converter is just a little cylinder with a piston in it. And when you turn this, it makes the piston go up. Creates a vacuum when it goes up. And that's what's going to draw the ink into the converter. The converter can come out if you pull on it like that. So we're going to start with a piston in the up position. This nib, let's get a look at that. It looks like it has a kind of a gold color to it, but I don't think it's a gold nib. Not at what it cost. I forgot how much I paid for this pen. I'll splash it onto the screen right about now. So, lavender, cobalt blue. Now, when you ink a pen, you want to have on hand some sort of tissue paper. And I have this piece of a paper towel that has a lemon on it. Let me turn up the microphone so you can hear this. now. You don't have to shake fountain pen ink. I only do it because I like the sound. If I put this in front of the bottle, maybe you can kind of see a hint of blue. Lavender, cobalt blue. It's a very pretty ink. Oh yeah. Would you look at that? That's nice. So we're going to take the pen and one other thing. A lot of times when I get a new pen, before I ink it, I'll wash it with some mild soap and water. You know, I'm just trying to get any kind of manufacturing residue off the pen. It kind of depends on the pen. This inexpensive pen like this, really not going to bother. So we're going to dip the pen up to about here. And then we're going to make the piston go down. I think the focus has changed a little bit. Let's recheck it. So we're going to make the piston go down, and that's going to expel any air that's in the cylinder, or the converter, I should say. And once it's all the way down, we'll go back up. That will create the vacuum that draws the ink into the converter. So here we go. I wish you could see this better. See that we have drawn ink into the converter. Sometimes I will go back down with a piston and draw ink up again to see if I can fit a little bit more. So let's try that. You can kind of see where it is. So make a note of that. Let's go back down. And then back up. A lot of times you'll get more ink on the second try. And as you can see, we did. So now we're going to use the tissue paper. This is a delicate procedure because you don't want to get ink on your fingers. I'd say we did a good job. So now we can safely hold the pen right here and not get anything on our fingers. So we're going to carefully screw the barrel. This is the barrel. We'll screw the barrel back on to the pen section. This black section with the threads. Yeah, let's call this section. We'll carefully put the cap on. Position the owl, position the bottle for what might end up being a video thumbnail. Okay. Now, before I do anything else, I'm not going to do anything else until I put the bottle back on the cap. Because, my friends, you do not want to spill a bottle of fountain pen ink. If you spill a bottle of fountain pen ink, it will ruin your day. Okay, so let's set that off to the side. Now we're gonna put some diamine ancient copper. You can kind of see a hint of the color. Let me turn that mic up. I could probably do a whole video on just that noise. I think that's going to be a good choice of color. same thing. Man, I just can't get over how good this looks. Same procedure. We'll start with the piston up. We'll have our tissue on standby. We'll back the owl up a little. Here we go. Now on this one, I think I'm just going to stop with one dip. Initiate the drying process. Okay. We're going to screw the barrel back onto the section. We're going to put the cap on it. Now, when I'm moving my hands around, I'm being very careful not to hit the ink bottle. And as I said before I do anything else, we're going to put the cap back on the bottle, or the jar. Some people call it a jar. We just don't want to spill the fountain pen ink, because if you spill fountain pen ink, and you've heard me say it 100 times. If you spill this, it will ruin your day. Now, we have both of these pens inked. We're going to make sure that they write. It doesn't screw off, it pulls off. I wonder how well this post, and what I mean by post is when you take the cap off, before you write, you can put the cap on the other end of the pen. And that post probably better than any pen I've ever seen. I wonder how that compares to the vintage Parker. That's okay on the vintage Parker, but it's not as good as this inexpensive Jinhao copy of the Parker. Boy, I like the way that does. very secure. Some people don't write with a cap posted. I prefer to post the cap usually. I just like the balance of the pen, the way it feels when it's posted. Sometimes it feels too light without the cap. So let me zoom in. Let's see here. Oops. And let's zoom out. I'm sorry to be so wishy-washy here. Let me get my focus and aid. Now, usually right out of the box, the first time you ink one, it may take a little bit of writing before it really starts to flow well. I'm not sure if this nib is a fine or a medium. Let's see if the label gave any indication. Doesn't really say. Seems to write pretty well. And the more I write, the smoother it gets. Like it. Let's try the other one. I keep wanting to... Most of my pins have screw-off caps. But that's a pull-off cap on the... on this pen. Now this one feels much different. The brown one writes like it's a fine nib, but this one writes as if it's a medium. This one is much smoother, and I know I just misspelled Jinhao. I'm aware of that. The pen kind of got away from me. And that's what happens when a pen writes extremely smooth. It's not as much feedback. A tactile, the resistance that you can feel. The more resistance, with the right amount of resistance, you can control you're writing better than if it's really smooth, it's like being on ice skates. It's hard to control. Got away from me again. This pen is so, so slick. This pen on this particular paper, and this paper is Clairefontaine. It's a 90-gram. Paper. It's very fountain pen friendly, meaning that it's really smooth, very smooth, and you don't get bleed through on the back of the page. But I just can't believe how smooth this is. You do not have to spend a lot of money to have fun in this hobby. Fountain pens don't have to cost an arm and a leg. And this is a good example of that. Oops, misspelled it. That is so smooth. It is great. The pen has no trouble keeping up with me. This particular pen, my friends, I think this is going to be a winner. Winner, winner. Chicken dinner. I think is what they say. Back to the brown one. It definitely feels like a fine. You can feel more resistance at the point the nib touches the paper. And you can just tell by the width of the line that each one makes. The blue is definitely probably a medium. And I don't know for sure. I should have went back and looked at the details before I made this video. I don't know if it's intentional that the nib on the brown pen seems to be narrower. I just don't know. Can't really make this out, but I think it's going to be the Jinhao symbol. I'm trying to remember what that is, like a chariot, a guy in a chariot or something. And it does say Jinhao right there. So we're going to wrap this video up in maybe probably the next video. We're going to do some more writing with these two pens. We're going to be opening up a pack of NBA Upper Deck basketball cards. These are what, 30 years old. This is 91-92 edition. Let me readjust the focus. So we're going to open these cards up in the next video. Take a look and see if we got anything of value. Maybe we can compose our thumbnail right now. That's about enough of that. You're probably asleep by now. I appreciate you watching this video. Please leave a thumbs up. It really helps the channel if you leave a thumbs up. And if you're a Patreon supporter of mine, I appreciate each and every one of you. And until next time, take care.